good morning, good morning. Our God is an awesome God. Let me say that for us again, that our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. The foundation of his reigning is his love. Our God is an awesome God. God has been good to us. This pandemic has showed us a lot of things. A lot of things about ourselves and a lot of things about each other. And one of the things that I want to put out before you this morning is that don't keep your struggles and your secrets to yourself. You need to release them. Let them go. God did not give us a spirit of fear, but of love, power, and of a sound mind. This has been your call to worship.
Yes, he did. so many more. Oh, yes, he does.
Us up this morning in our right minds, able to move, breathe, and function, Father. Thank you for allowing us to be able to get to the church today, Father. We thank you for loving us, keeping us, blessing us, guiding us, guarding us, protecting us, using us, anointing us, showing us favor. We thank you that we're not in lack, our needs are met, our bills are paid, and we're millionaires. We're rich in you, Jesus. We're rich in your love. We thank you for your grace and your mercy. You truly have been merciful and gracious to us, Father. We thank you for Hillcrest Baptist Church in its entirety, every member, every ministry, every leader. Thank you for Pastor Robinson and Veronica, and anoint, continue to bless them and anoint them for the work that they have to do, Father God. We pray for all the sick and shut-in people in the world. Comfort them, give them peace, heal their bodies, take their pain away, and if they're terminal, take them on home. Don't let them suffer. Pray for all the bereaved people in the world, because it certainly hurts to lose a loved one. Comfort their hearts and give them peace, Lord. We pray for the homeless, Lord. Help them to find food, clothing, and shelter. And help us to be a part of that, Father God. When we see somebody homeless, help us to help that person, Lord. We pray for the world leaders, Lord. Every leader from every country. Help them to make wise decisions for their country, because every decision they make affects everybody in that country. We pray for those who don't know you, Father. Father God, and depart in their sins. Send somebody to preach to them, to tell them about you, Lord Jesus, and help them to accept you as their Lord and Savior, Father God. We pray that we can be instrumental in bringing others to Christ, Lord Jesus. Use us, Lord. Use us to help others, to draw others to you. Let our light so shine that others will see it and want a closer walk with you, Father God. We thank you for using us. We praise you. We give you glory, Lord. We pray that you walk with us, go with us, and stand by us today, Lord. Anoint the work of our hands and use us to help somebody some kind of way today, Lord Jesus. We bless your name and we give you glory. We magnify you and we lift your name on high. These things we pray in the matchless, marvelous, magnificent name of your Son, Christ Jesus. And we call it done with much thanksgiving. Amen and amen. Now the Lord said to Abram, go from your country and your kindred and your father's house to the land that I will show you. And I will make you a great nation, and I will bless you and make your name great so that you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and him who dishonors you I will curse. And in all you, the families of the earth shall be blessed. So Abram went, and as the Lord had told him, and Lot went with him. Abram was 75 years old when he departed from Haran. And Abram took Sarai, his wife, and Lot, his brother's son, and all their possessions that they had gathered, and the people that they had acquired in Haran. And they set out to go to the land of Canaan. When they came to the land of Canaan, Abram passed through the land to the place of Shechem, to the oak of Moreh. At that time, the Canaanites were in the land. Then the Lord appeared to Abram and said, to your offspring I will give this land. So he built there an altar to the Lord who had appeared to him. May God add a blessing to the reading of his word.
Thank you. testimony of the saints throughout the ages, that he touched me and made me whole. Just one touch from Jesus makes all the difference in your life. And we are here this morning to testify to the fact that we have been touched by the Savior, and we have been transformed. Amen? Amen, amen. So great to see those of you here and to be before those of you at home. We are glad for another Sunday morning to gather together to give God the glory, honor, and praise that he and he alone deserves. Because he is the only one who is God all by himself. He is the only one who raised us this morning. And he is the one who's been keeping us and protecting us all throughout our lives. Amen and amen. So glad to have each and every one of you here on this morning. Just a couple quick announcements. First of all, our weekly prayer call is Tuesday morning at 7 a.m. Information is on your screen. Our weekly prayer call Tuesday morning at 7 a.m. Start your Tuesdays off with prayer with your Hillcrest family. And then on Wednesday is our Bible class, Wednesday in the Word. Wednesdays at noon or 7 p.m. on Zoom. And if you need the information, just send us an email to info@hillcrestweb.org. That's info@hillcrestweb.org to join us as we study the book of Revelation. This week we'll be in Revelation chapter 12. Revelation chapter 12. And so a couple verses to finish up in 11, then we will cover chapter 12 on this week. And so meet us this Wednesday at noon or 7 p.m. for Wednesday in the Word. Also, we will be hosting, Hillcrest Baptist Church will be hosting a drive-through COVID vaccination on July 9th. If you have not been vaccinated or someone you know has not been vaccinated, you need to meet us here on Friday, July 9th from 9 a.m. to 12. From 9 to noon, we'll be hosting a drive-through vaccination. Illinois Department of Health will be here vaccinating anyone who shows up, but it's best for us if you register first. So you can call the church office at this point to register, 708-799-8300. 708-799-8300, Monday through Thursday. You can call from 10 to 3 to register, or if you have questions. And then coming up to the event, we'll have online registration available. But for right now, we need you to call the church office to register. And we need everyone, everyone and everyone to be vaccinated so that we can all gather together and so that we can be as healthy and as safe as possible. Amen? Amen. Amen. All right, Hillcrest family, July 11th, second Sunday of July, will be Family and Friends Day. And so if you plan to attend with us on Family and Friends Day, of course, please register. In the month of July, we'll be increasing capacity to 100 people. So in the month of July, we'll be increasing capacity to 100. And so if you plan on joining us for Family and Friends Day, bringing family and friends with you, please go and register so that we can have room for you. And then Sunday, July 18th, we'll be celebrating all of our graduates. So all of our graduates will be celebrating on July 18th. Graduates from 2020 and 2021 will be recognized on the 18th. And so if you have not contacted church office with your graduates' information, please do so immediately. All right. Sharon, is this for you? Okay. Okay. If you were here in worship on Youth Sunday, May 30th, and you lost a ring, if you were here on Youth Sunday and you lost a ring, call the church office. So if you're here right now, come see me after service. You lost a ring, and we have it. And so if you were here Youth Sunday and you lost, it's a woman's ring, then contact us so we can make sure that you get your ring back. Amen. 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 I want to thank all the sisters that came out yesterday for women's ministry on Zoom. They had a great celebration on yesterday. Focusing on believing God. It's one thing to know there is a God. It's another thing to believe in him and trust in him each and every day. And so they had a wonderful session focused on believing God. Beth Moore did a wonderful job helping us to understand how to walk by faith. Amen, amen. Appreciate all the sisters that came out and the great time that they have. With that being done, Hillcrest family, it is time to take a moment for offerings. So if you have not had a chance to pay tithes and offerings this week, now would be a good opportunity to do so. There are multiple, amen, somebody's glad to pay offerings, pay their tithes. That's a good thing. We ought to be joyous in giving back to the God who gives so freely unto us. There are multiple ways that you can pay tithes and offerings. You can go to the website, hillcrestweb.org, click the Give tab. You can go to our app and you can give through the app. You can text support HBC. Just text the word support HBC to the number 77977, and you can give by text. Or if you're here in the building, you can just put in an envelope, and after service on your way out, the ushers will have a basket for you. For those of you at home that would like to mail in a paper offering, you can do so. The Hillcrest Baptist Church, 17300 Pulaski Road in Country Club Hills, Illinois, 60478, 60478. And we thank each and every one of you for your continued support of the ministry of Hillcrest Baptist Church. Amen and amen. We couldn't do any of what we do without the continued support of the saints to help us continue to reach the south suburbs and the world with the gospel of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. With that being said, Hillcrest family, let's prepare our hearts and our minds for prayer on this morning. Stand where you are, or you can come down to the altar. We are going to take this time to go before the Lord in prayer, to lift up our loved ones, our church, our community, and our world before you. So good to see my friend Mario Long here today. Amen, amen. Mario and I are friends from the neighborhood. We go way, way, way back. So it's a blessing to see him and his lovely wife here today. Amen, amen. So glad to see you both. Let us go before the Lord as we pray on today. Father, we are grateful. Grateful for your manifold love. Grateful for the grace that is you in our lives. Grateful, Lord, for your Son and our Savior, Jesus Christ, and the sacrifice that he has made, that all who believe in him can have eternal life. And we're grateful, Father God, that by your grace, you decided to wake us up this morning. Father, we realize that every day is a gift. We know we take them for granted at times, but every day is a gift. You don't have to wake us up, but each day you have, and for that we say thank you. Not only do you wake us up, Father God, but you wake us up and you have a plan and purpose for us every day. You wake us up on purpose and for a purpose, and for that we give you glory, honor, and praise. Help us, O Lord, to seek your face every day. Help us, O Lord, to open your word. Help us, O Lord, to call upon you in prayer, that we may fellowship with you, have intimate time with you, that you may reveal to us that which you've called and created us for, and that which you've desired for us to do today. We know, O Lord, that you've given us a great commission and a great commandment. You've called us to go out and share the gospel, teaching people to obey all that you've commanded. And you've called us to love you with all our heart, mind, and soul, and our neighbor as ourselves. So help us, O Lord, to do both of those things each and every day. To love you first, and to let that love for you permeate to everyone we come in contact with. And because we love them, to tell them the truth about who Jesus Christ is. To tell them that they don't have to continue to be imprisoned to their sins. That they don't have to be imprisoned to their past. That they don't have to be imprisoned to the consequences of their negative choices, Father God. But that there is freedom, grace, and salvation in Jesus and Jesus alone. Thank you, Lord, for loving us the way you do. And thank you, Lord, for hearing and answering the prayers of your children. Lord, we lift our country before you. We pray, O Lord, that these yet-to-be United States of America will repent from their sins and call upon your name for salvation. We pray, Father God, for an end to this pandemic, And we pray, Father God, for an end to the disease of racism that has affected this country ever since its foundation. We know, Father, that there is a better foundation for this country, and it is Christ our Savior. We know, Father God, that there is a better way to love our neighbor, and that's by submitting to your word, your will, and your way. And we know, Father God, you created us all in your image. We thank you, Father, for the conviction of Derek Chauvin this week. And we pray, Father, that justice for police officers who break the law becomes normal in our country. We pray, Father God, that every citizen is treated as created in your image, that every citizen has the same rights and privileges, and that this country lives up to the Constitution that it has written. Father, we know that ultimately justice is always found in you. And so help us, O Lord, to stand on your word until we see your will done in our daily lives. May your kingdom come, and may your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Then, Father, we lift our brothers and sisters before you on the prayer list this morning, praying for each of them. Father, you know exactly what they need. Praying your healing hand be upon Quentin Flowers, praying for Leslie Bacon and Priscilla Copeland, and for Sharon Grandison, O Lord, continue to heal and strengthen her. Praying, O Lord, for Kenneth Grant, and praying your healing hand be upon Karen Guyton and Faurice Hollins, Linda Hooker and Belinda Livingston, Artemis Rialz and Marilyn Riley, Robert Rucker and Marvin Anthony Smith, Annie Somerville and Odessa Terry, Aaron Ward and Tywo Wheat. Praying, O Lord, for your comfort on Tywo and his family in the passing of his grandmother. Praying, O Lord, for Lawton Wilkerson and for Jessica Worthy. Praying, Father God, for the entire Hillcrest family, every home, house by house, and heart by heart. May your presence reign, may your spirit flow, and may your healing presence be abundant in all of our lives. We need you, Lord, and because we need you, we come before you. Because we need you, we call upon your name. And Lord, because we need you, we repent of our sins and look to you for direction, for strength, and for healing. These are the things we ask in the matchless name of your Son and our Savior. It's in Jesus' mighty name that we pray. And all God's people say amen.
Just a few seconds. I know we got to go on. pray. If you walked in here, stand on your 2 feet, put your hands in the air, and give God praise. Hallelujah.
Jesus, Jesus wins. Lord.
Testimony of people who've seen him fight their battle, who've gotten out of the way and let God be God, who stood on his word and seen him come through time after time after time after time. And now we can gladly testify that Jesus will fight your battle. Jesus will come through when you need him. Yes, he will. Father, we thank and praise your holy name. For truly, Lord, there's none like you. We thank you, Father, for your faithfulness. We thank you, Father, that you keep your promises. We thank you, Father, that you have fought our battles, and that you and you alone are undefeated. And Lord, we give you all glory, honor, and praise. Have your way today, O Lord. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. And all God's people said, amen. If you can, stand with me and turn your Bibles to Galatians chapter 3. Galatians chapter 3. Four verses for your hearing today. Galatians chapter 3, verses 15 through 18. In your New Testament, 1st and 2nd Corinthians. Galatians, if you get to Ephesians, you went a little bit too far. Galatians chapter 3, verses 15 through 18. Galatians chapter 3, verses 15 through 18. Yeah. Reading from the English Standard Version, my Bible says, to give a human example, brothers, even with a man-made covenant, no one annuls it or adds to it once it's been ratified. Now the promises were made to Abraham and to his offspring. It does not say, and to offsprings, referring to many, but referring to one, and to your offspring, who is Christ. This is what I mean. The law, which came 430 years afterwards, does not annul a covenant previously ratified by God, so as to make the promise void. For if the inheritance comes by law, it no longer comes by promise. But God gave it to Abraham by a promise. Amen. 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 The word of God for the people of God this morning, we're going to tag this text, Living on a Promise. Amen. Living on a promise. Two little girls were talking outside after class. And they were decided to see who had the most money in their purse. One little girl reached in her purse and she pulled out one, two, three, four, five, six. I've got six pennies. Another little girl reached down to her purse and said, wait a minute. One, two, three, four, five, ten. I've got 10 pennies. I won. The first little girl looked at her and said, wait a minute, I only see 5 pennies in your hand. And she said, yeah, but my dad told me when I got home today, he was going to give me 5 cents. So I've got 10, the 5 in my hand and the 5 that my father promised me. She was living on a promise. The Apostle Paul today is telling us that the entire church is living on a promise. He's been faithfully demonstrating throughout the book of Galatians that God's method of salvation has never changed. That from the Old Testament to the New Testament, it's always been salvation by faith and justification by faith. In the previous text in Galatians 3, 1 through 14, Paul proves to us from the Old Testament and the New Testament that it's always been salvation by grace through faith. But now in our text today, Paul takes an example from the legal court to illustrate this same truth, because there were those in the church in Galatia that were being deceived into thinking that you could work your way to salvation. False teachers had come in among them and were teaching them that you had to be Jewish in order to accept Christ, that you had to obey the Jewish laws and follow the Jewish rituals and act just like Jewish people in order to be received by God and in order to be saved. And so they had turned the reading of the Old Testament into a bunch of laws when that's not what God designed it to be in the first place. Too often we read the Old Testament and all we see is laws, when the truth is the Old Testament is filled with promises. Don't let the laws get in the way of the promises God has given to his people, because we are a people who live on the promises of God. And so quickly, I want to show you two things out this text. First, it shows us the permanence of a human covenant. Look at verses 15 to 16 in your Bible. Paul is demonstrating that the permanence of the promises of God made to Abraham in Genesis 12, that we read earlier in this service, could not be amended by the laws that God gave to Moses. In Genesis 12, 2 and 3, God made a covenant with Abraham. And he says, I will make you a great nation. I will bless you and make your name great so that you will be a blessing. I will bless all who bless you, and all who dishonor you I will curse, and in you all the families of the earth will be blessed. Genesis 12, verses 2 and 3. Paul's point is that God only attached one condition to the covenant he made with Abraham. And that covenant promise was that Abraham would believe in God. He didn't say, if you do this, this, and this, then I'll bless you. He says, I will bless you. I will make your name great. I will bless those who bless you, and I will curse those who curse you. And in you, all the families of the earth will be blessed. And the only condition of the covenant was that Abraham believed God. We told you last time in Galatians 3 and 6 that Abraham believed God, and it was accounted to him for righteousness. That justification has always been by faith alone. That those who place their faith in God receive relationship with God based solely on our faith. God did not say, do this and do that and you will be blessed. No, God's covenant with Abraham was by faith and not by works. And because God is holy and God is righteous and God is immutable, meaning his character does not change, he's the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow. And so don't believe that there's a God of the Old Testament and a God of the New Testament. There's one God who's been ministering to humanity throughout the ages in one way. And the only way to have a relationship with him is by faith. Amen. Paul wants us to see that from the very beginning, God hasn't changed the method of how to have a relationship with him. It's always been and always will be by faith. So Paul points out that God did not make a promise to Abraham and then later change the conditions to attach on something else. He grants the covenant by faith in Genesis 12, and then he would not later change the rules. God don't play bait and switch. You know how bait and switch goes. You go to look on the internet, you're shopping for a car, and they say, oh yeah, we got this great car up here, come on down, and for $20,000, you can drive it off the lot. Yeah. And you get there, and they start tacking in dealer fee, cleaning fee, internet fee, whatever I can else think of fee, and before you know it, it's $30,000. It's like, no, that's not the price you told me on the internet. Well, that doesn't apply in this situation because fill in the blank. That's the old bait and switch. Well, God doesn't play bait and switch with the people of God. The covenant has always been by faith. And so for the Judaizers to say that you also have to obey all the laws to have a right relationship with God was them trying to add to God's covenant in the first place. God would never introduce a new way of salvation and alter the way that he had promised because it always was by faith. So in verses 15, Paul gives a human example to illustrate this point. He says, to give a human example, brothers and sisters, even with a man-made covenant, no one annuls it or adds to it once it's been ratified. And so Paul helps the Galatians church and us to understand that even human covenants are binding once they've been ratified. When you buy a house, you sign a covenant. You sign a mortgage agreement. It's a promissory note. It's a contract. And you and the bank sit down at the table and go over the terms of the contract. And then you and the bank sign paper upon paper upon paper saying that you are going to both live out the terms of this contract. Now imagine you went home, got the keys to your new house, sat down at your new kitchen table, and decided you were going to make some addendums to the contract. Say you went home and lowered your rate. Just erased the rate that was in there and decided to make it 0%. Say you went home and decided, I don't want to pay a 10-year mortgage, a 30-year mortgage, I'm going to make it 10. And so you scratched out 30, wrote in 10 in your own handwriting. You would have no authority in making the bank admit to your terms. Because those weren't the terms the two of you came to the table and signed. Paul used this same argument here. He says, even in a man-made covenant, no one annuls it or adds to it once it's been ratified. Once you sign the contract, the terms of the contract are final. You don't get to change the contract after it's been signed. So Paul says there's no bait and switch with God. That the covenant he made, the contract he made with Abraham, was by faith. Abraham believed God, and it was accounted to him as righteousness. Well, if it's true in human covenants, then how much more is it true with a holy and righteous God? God would not change the terms. God would not add something to it after it had already been established. And he says to Abraham, I will bless you, I will make your name great, and through you all the families of the earth will be blessed. The covenant was strictly by faith. Matter of fact, when Abraham and God made this covenant, there wasn't even a law yet. That's what Paul says later in the verse. He said it was 430 years later before Moses received the Ten Commandments. Yeah. And so the law came later. The covenant has always been and always will be by faith. Yeah. So someone's saying, yeah, but what's that got to do with me? Well, the Holy Spirit knew you were going to ask that. And so we had Paul write verse 16. Now the promises were made to Abraham and to his offspring. It does not say to his offsprings, referring to many, but referring to one. Here Paul helps us to understand that God made a promise to Abraham, but it was also to Abraham's seed, to his descendant. Notice it doesn't say seeds, plural, because all of Abraham's physical descendants did not inherit the promise. Only the spiritual descendants of Abraham, only those who followed in Abraham's footsteps and believed God by faith, received the covenant with God. Let me show it to you. Abraham had two sons. One was Isaac, one was Ishmael. But the promise was transmitted to Isaac. Isaac had two sons. One was Jacob and one was Esau. But the promise was transmitted to Jacob. And so Paul's point is that the covenant between God and Abraham is to those who believed God and followed in Abraham's footsteps. It's to those who are Abraham's spiritual children, not just his physical children. But Paul also uses seed in the singular here for another reason. He wants you to see that the covenant wasn't just to Abraham, that the covenant was through Abraham to Jesus Christ. The reason he uses seed in the singular here is an allusion to the fact that the coming Messiah would be a descendant of Abraham. And so when God makes a covenant with Abraham, really God's making a covenant with himself. He says, I'm going to bring a Messiah through your bloodline. He is my son, but he's going to be your seed. And to him I swear that all who believe in him by faith will have right relationship with me. You need to know that God always keeps his promises. What began by faith has continued by faith, and anyone who places their faith in Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior shall be saved. Matthew 1:1 says, the book of the genealogy of Jesus Christ, the son of David, the son of Abraham. Why does Matthew say that? Because Matthew wants his Jewish audience to know that the family line of Jesus comes through their most king and the father of the faith. He wants them to see that Jesus came down through them in fulfillment to God's promise to Abraham. Matter of fact, Jesus is the root of this promise in the first place. By trusting Christ for salvation of our sins, we become children of God and children of Abraham. We become the family of God. Abraham was pointing to Christ. That's why Jesus said in John 8:56, your father Abraham was overjoyed that he would see my day, and he saw it and rejoiced. He says because Abraham was looking forward to Jesus coming, because Jesus is the one who the promise is founded upon. Abraham was justified by faith. That simply means that he put his faith in God, and God put his righteousness in Abraham's account. God said, okay, Abraham, you believe in me. Now you're part of my family. Now we are in relationship. Now we can have intimacy. Now you can talk to me, and I will answer your prayers. Now I will intercede on your behalf, and I will place in you my spirit so that I will always dwell within you. He was justified by faith, but that faith was in the promise of God. God said, I'm going to do all of this. And Abraham said, I believe that you're God, and you're going to do what you said you're going to do. Yeah. Hear me, church? That's how you show that you are one of Abraham's children. You believe God's word. Yeah. That's how you show that you truly are a child of God, that when God speaks, you trust God. And even when God speaks and you don't see what God says, you trust him until you see it. Amen. That's the testimony of Abraham. He said, pack up your stuff and go to a land in which I will tell you. Genesis chapter 12. If God told you, pack up, you're going on a journey, I tell you where you're going when you get there. Most of y'all wouldn't move. I need more details. I need to know the whole plan. I need to know exactly where we're going, step by step by step. But the life of God is a walk by faith. When God speaks, we move because we trust God. And if he's got to tell you every step of the way, then you don't need faith because you got all the details. But the just shall live by faith. Abraham was justified by faith in the promises of God, and that promise ever since the beginning has been pointing to Jesus Christ. Christ perfectly lived the life of faith that's described in Scripture. Christ died a substitutionary death so that all who place their faith in him shall receive the blessing of Abraham, friendship with God. So Jesus is not only the mediator of our salvation, but he's also the foundation of our faith. That's why the church continues to sing, my hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ, the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. Paul helps us to see the permanence of a human covenant, but he does so to point us to the priority and permanence of God's promises. Look back at your Bible, verse 17 and 18. He says, this is what I mean. The law, which came 430 years afterwards, does not annul a covenant previously ratified by God so as to make the promise void. For if the inheritance comes by the law, it no longer comes by promise, but God gave it to Abraham by a promise. Here's the issue. The Judaizers, those people who were trying to infiltrate the Galatians church by teaching a false doctrine, were arguing that since the law came after Abraham, that the law had priority, and that salvation by faith alone was not enough, that you also had to obey the law. But Paul argues to the contrary. He says the covenant came first, and the covenant and the promise cannot be changed. And that the law does not have priority over the covenant has priority over the law. So he says the law came 430 years later. And so the law does not annul a covenant previously ratified by God. Once again, God don't play bait and switch. He's faithful. And if he gives you a promise, he's not going to add and change the terms of the promise later. God always sticks by his word. God's covenant with Abraham was given 430 years before Moses received the Ten Commandments. And so the promise comes first, then comes the law. Matter of fact, it's promise, law, and then Christ, who's the fulfillment of both. And so the promise goes first. When God gave the law to Moses, he did not overthrow his covenant of salvation by faith. He did not install a works-based relationship system. No, but the Judaizers were trying to teach that. And people are still trying to teach you today that you have to work your way to God. Religion after religion lines up with the same weak excuse and says you have to work your way to God. You've got to do this and do that, and you've got to do this and do that, and then maybe God will like you. Well, no, the Bible says that you are sick in your sins, that all your works are filthy rags, and there's nothing you can do to work your way into right relationship with God. But God in his grace has offered salvation to anyone by faith in Jesus Christ. And so you don't have to do the work. You have to believe in the work that Jesus has already done at the cross of Calvary. And all who believe shall be saved. So you can't work your way to God. God has already done the work to build the bridge between man and him. And that bridge was at the cross of Calvary in the death, resurrection, and burial of Jesus Christ. You can't work your way to heaven. You can't work your way into a right relationship with God. Hear the word of God. Romans 1:16-17 says, I'm not ashamed of the gospel, for it's the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. For it is in the righteousness of God is revealed from faith for faith. As it is written, the righteous shall live by faith. Amen. We don't live by works. We live by faith. We don't walk by works. We walk by faith. Faith is and always will be the permanent path to salvation. The Old Testament saints were saved by faith. New Testament saints are saved by faith. And no one can draw near to God unless they do it by faith. That's what Hebrews 11:6 tells us. Without faith, it's impossible to please God. For whoever would draw near to God must believe first that he exists, and second, that he rewards those who diligently seek him. Amen. Finally, Paul says, for if the inheritance comes by law, it no longer comes by promise. But God gave it to Abraham by a promise. There it is. Paul says, if it was about the law, then it's no longer by faith. If you have to do the work to please God, then the life of God, the Christian life, is not a life of faith. But if you have to believe God to have a right relationship with him, then it is by faith. So he said, if the inheritance comes by law, then it's not a promise. You got to work for your inheritance, then it hasn't been promised to you. But if you receive it by faith, then it's in fulfillment of the promise. And then he closes it out and says, but God gave it to Abraham by a promise. When you go back and study Genesis chapter 12, Genesis chapter 15, Genesis chapter 17, where God repeats his covenant with Abraham all three times, nowhere are there additions to the promise. Nowhere are there stipulations that Abraham has to work for. He simply says, by my grace, I've chosen you, and I will make you a great nation. I will make your seed great. And in you, all the nations will be blessed. It was a covenant by faith. God made a promise. Abraham believed, and the Bible says that he believed in God, and it was accounted to him as righteousness. So Paul says, for if the inheritance comes by the law, it no longer comes by the promise. When Paul talks about the inheritance, he's talking about justification by faith. He's talking about us having a right relationship with God based on our faith in God. This is the greatest gift that Abraham receives in the covenant. We see God promised that he's going to give him the land of promise, the land of Canaan, and we get all excited. Oh, I wish God gave me a whole country. We see God say, I'm going to make your seed great. So I wish God gave me a whole bunch of kids and grandkids. But the greatest gift that Abraham received is the gift of God.
Amen.
The greatest thing he could receive was a right relationship with God. And it didn't come by works. It came by faith.
Amen.
God didn't have to give it to him. But in his grace, he decided to gift Abraham with a right relationship. And Abraham could not earn it. He had to believe to receive it. It was received by faith. And brothers and sisters, it's the same for every child of God. For everyone who ever was saved and everyone who ever will be saved, salvation is available only by faith.
Amen.
The Judaizers of Paul's day and the legalistic people of our own day have the same misunderstanding. They believe that the law comes first when the Bible is clear that faith and grace come before the law. But Paul proves to us all that grace comes before the law and that grace has permanence over the law. So everybody here must decide, how are you going to live your life? Am I going to live by the law or am I going to live on the promises of God? Are you going to live by your own works, or are you going to live by faith in the works already completed at the cross of Calvary by Jesus Christ? For the truth of the matter is, man cannot succeed in perfectly keeping the law. All you got to do is read your Bible and see that. Adam couldn't keep the law. Joseph couldn't keep the law. Moses couldn't keep the law. Abraham couldn't keep the law. Noah couldn't keep the law. And you can't keep the law either. No human being can perfectly keep the law. But the good news is that God cannot fail in perfectly keeping his promise. And so salvation by faith doesn't depend on our power. It depends on trusting the word of God. You can't keep the law, but God always keeps his promises. And so put your faith in the one who's always faithful. Lamentations 3:23 says, the steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies are new every morning. Great is his faithfulness. And because God is faithful, he has a promise for everything that you need. That's why the church lives on the promises of God. If you need salvation, there's a promise for that. John 3:16 says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. If you're feeling all alone, there's a promise for that. Hebrews 13:5 says, I will never leave you or forsake you. If you need an answer to your prayers, there's a promise for that. 1 John 5:14 says, and this is the confidence we have toward him. If we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. And if we need forgiveness, there's a promise for that. 1 John 1:9 says, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And so let us hold fast to the promises of God, because he who promised is faithful. Let me help you see it. Booker T. Washington, in his book, Up From Slavery, describes a meeting he had with an ex-slave in Virginia. He says, I found this man who had made a contract with his master 2 or 3 years before the Emancipation Proclamation, to the effect that the slave was permitted to buy himself free by paying every year on his redemption price. He was permitted to go outside of the master's house to work in order to gain the money to buy to set himself free. So he moved to Ohio because he could make more money there. And then when he found out that he was free, he said, well, I still owe my master $300. I understand what the Emancipation Proclamation says, but I made a promise to my master. And so this black man walked the greater portion of the distance from Ohio back to Virginia to place the last dollar in his master's hand to purchase his freedom. In talking to Booker T. Washington about this, he says, the man told me he knew he didn't have to pay, but he had given a promise, and he says, my promise is greater than any law.
Amen.
Well, brothers and sisters, on a higher and holier level, God's promises are greater than any law. And when it came time to pay our debt, to pay the debt for the sins of humanity, Jesus didn't have to pay. But he came down because he kept his promise. Luke 24 and 44 says, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms must be fulfilled." And so Jesus didn't have to pay the debt, but he did have to keep his promise. And I don't know about you, but I'm glad Jesus kept that promise. I'm glad he came down from his heavenly home, came down to a cross called Calvary, took on your sins and mine, and laid down his life that all who believe can have eternal life. I don't know about you, but I'm glad he kept that promise. He who knew no sin became sin, that we might become the righteousness of God. I'm glad that he kept his promise, because God always keeps his promises. All the promises of God find their yes in Jesus Christ. That is why through him we utter our amen to God for his glory. So brothers and sisters, truly we are standing on the promises of God. We live on the promise. We receive salvation through a promise. Fulfillment through a promise. Sanctification through a promise. Justification through a promise. And one of these days we'll see him face to face, because God always keeps his promises. So your homework this week is to go home and live on the promises of God. Every time Satan says something to you about what you can't do, what you shouldn't do, or what you cannot do, you just remind him of what your Father has already told you he will do, and then stand on his promises. He will never leave you or forsake you. He is always ready and willing to forgive you, and he's always ready to hear and answer your prayers. Trust in the promises of God, because God always keeps his promises. There it is, standing on the promises of Christ our King. Through eternal ages, let his praises ring. Glory, hallelujah, to the newborn King. We are standing on the promises of God. Father, we thank and praise your holy name, because there is none like you. Always faithful, always trustworthy. And Lord, by your amazing grace, you've given the promise of salvation to all who place their faith in your Son. And so, Father, we say thank you, because we couldn't earn it. We say thank you because we don't deserve it. We say thank you because out of your manifold grace, you decided to save us. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for loving us the way you do. And thank you, Lord, for hearing and answering our deepest need even before we knew that we needed it, and sending us your Son and our Savior, Jesus Christ. In his name we pray, and all God's people said, amen. Amen. If you're able, rise to your feet for just a moment. Someone here needs to live on the promises of God. You've experienced people breaking promises to you your whole life. But you need to know that God is the one who never breaks his promises. That God is always faithful, always has been, and always will be. And that he has offered a promise to you. It's a promise of salvation. John 3:16 says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever," that means anyone, "whosoever that believes in him shall not perish." There's the promise right there. That anyone who places their faith in Jesus Christ will receive the gift of eternal life and will never be separated from God. So if you're here today, in the building or at home watching and worshiping, and you aren't sure that if you died today, you would spend eternal life with Jesus Christ, what we know is heaven, this first invitation is for you. An invitation to accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. Shall there be one? Facebook feed. You can email us at info@hillcrestweb.org, or you can call the church office 708-799-8300. Let us know that you've made the decision to accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. Shall there be one? My Lord and Savior, but I don't have a church home. I don't have brothers and sisters I meet with on a regular basis, not just to hear someone preach the word, but to learn how to apply the word of God to the situations and circumstances of my life, to learn how to be a disciple of Jesus Christ, and not just a member of a church, to have brothers and sisters to come alongside of me and cheer me on when I get it right, to pick me up when I get it wrong, and to love me either way. You need a church family. And so if that's you today, we send this invitation. If you're here in the building, you can take the front row. If you're at home, once again, you can comment on the Facebook page or you can send us an email to info@hillcrestweb.org. That's hillcrestweb.org. Shall there be one? Righteousness of Jesus Christ in us, that we can walk worthy before you, that we can come to you and pray anytime, that we can enter into your gates with thanksgiving, that we can walk into the presence of the holy and living God and not be fearful or afraid, because the blood of Christ cleanses us from our sins. And we thank you, Father God, for your word today. It continues to refresh our souls and encourage our hearts. Pray, Father God, for those who are still wrestling with trusting you. And we pray, Father God, that you would touch their hearts, that they too may believe. We pray for your church, Father God, that we would not just believe that you exist, but that we will walk by faith each and every day, that the world may see you at work in us and be drawn into yourself. And then, Father, we just thank you for the amazing grace that is your love toward us. Oh, the depths and riches and wisdom and knowledge of God. How unsearchable are his judgments, how inscrutable are his ways. For who has known the mind of the Lord, or who has been his counselor, or who has given a gift that he might be repaid? For from him and through him and to him are all things. To him be glory forever and ever and ever. Sanctuary, you are.